Well, let's hear it nice and loud so people listening on the radio and online can hear it. Ready? Happy Sunday! How many of you are excited to be in church this morning? Let's see a show of hands. All right, how many of you woke up in a good mood today because you said, you know what, this is the day God is going to do something good for me? All right, I'm so happy you're all here today. We're in a series right now, a series called Love Life. We call it that because I want you to love life. And I want people who are close to you to say, you know what, that person loves life, and that person is the most loving person I have ever met before in my life. And so what we're doing is we're applying the principles of Jesus, and we're learning in our own life. We're kind of practicing in our own life, trying to love Jesus' style. Because after all, Jesus said these words. He said, I'm giving you a new commandment. Love each other the same way I have loved you. In other words, what you've seen me do, how I've treated you, how I've acted around you, that's how I want you to act with other people. I want you to pass that on to other people. He said, I have given you an example to follow. Do as I have done to you. So today we're going to do two things. Number one, we're going to look at how much Jesus really, really does love you. And number two, we're going to look at how we get to pass that on to the people around us. So let's jump right into this right now. First of all, if I'm going to love like Jesus, I'm going to accept others like Jesus accepts me. If you're taking notes on your outline right now, you might want to write that down. I'm going to accept others the way Jesus accepts me. Now, think about this. We, as followers of Jesus, should be the most accepting people in the world, the least judgmental people in the world. If we're followers of Jesus, we should be accepting of people, the most accepting, bar none. And the fact is, psychologically, probably the deepest wounds you've ever experienced in your entire life have been the wounds you've experienced from rejection. They're the things that hurt you the most. You were belittled. You were betrayed. Maybe you were pushed aside. And someone that you cared about told you, you're not worth anything. You'll never amount to anything. Maybe it was your parents when you were growing up. Maybe it was a former spouse. But a lot of us have experienced it. And most of us would do anything we could do in our life not to go through that again, just to avoid that feeling. So we think, you know what? If I could just be perfect. You know, if I always look perfect to everybody, if I dress perfectly and I lose that extra 10 pounds and I look the best I possibly can, if I don't show anybody my weaknesses, if everybody only sees me being perfect all the time, then they've got to like me. They've got to accept me. Well, I hate to tell you this, but that's just plain wrong. Jesus was perfect and they hung him on a cross. And I hate to tell you this, but no matter what you do, somebody's not going to like you. No matter what you say, somebody is going to disagree. Someone is going to reject you. But there is one person in your life who will never, ever reject you. There is one person who will always see the best in you, who will always welcome you, who will always accept you, no matter what. And that person is Jesus. That person is Jesus. How does Jesus love you? You know, Jesus once said this, the Father gives me my people, like you're a gift to him. The Father gives me my people, every one of them will come to me, and I will always accept them. Here at church, we talk about accepting Jesus. You probably heard people say, have you accepted Christ in your life? Have you accepted Jesus in your heart? Well, I can tell you this, whether or not you've accepted Jesus, he's accepted you. He accepts you just the way you are. You could be a Christian your entire life and still never totally feel accepted by God. You feel like God is always judging you. You feel like God is always putting you down. He's always demanding. He's always on your case. And no matter what, you just can't do enough good. Well, let me tell you something. That feeling of never being good enough to be accepted, that feeling isn't coming from God. It's probably coming from growing up with unpleasable parents, but it's not coming from God. A lot of us grew up with parents who just couldn't please. And every one of us in this place grew up experiencing conditional love. Conditional. Because all of us, nobody can love you unconditionally. No human being can always totally love you unconditionally. We learn love like, I love you if you do these things. Or I love you because of these reasons. So we learn conditional love. But God says, no, I just love you, period. I don't love you because of who you are. I love you because of who I am. God says, I love you unconditionally. And I will always accept you just the way you are. I will always welcome you just the way you are. I will always see the good in you. Now, I understand that can be hard to internalize. Again, because many of you grew up with unpleasable parents. And no matter what you did, it wasn't good enough. Maybe you got some B's and they said, we want you to have A's. And you got A's and they said, we want you to have all A's. And you always had the feeling that no matter what you did, it's not good enough. You know, like, I'm not measuring up to dad's expectations. Or I'm not living up to mom's wishes. I'm a big disappointment. And they let you know it. And even today as a grown adult, some of you are still trying to earn the approval of an unpleasable parent. In fact, your parents may be dead. And you're still thinking in your mind, I'm going to show them. Boy, I'm going to show them. I'm going to show them I'm valuable, that I'm acceptable, that I'm worthy of love. Well, let me say something to you as your pastor, as your friend, as somebody who loves you. If you don't have their acceptance yet, if you don't have your parents' approval yet, you aren't going to get it. Sorry to tell you that. It has nothing to do with you. It has everything to do with them. Hurt people hurt people. Wounded people wound people. If you don't have your parents' approval by now, you're not going to get it. But here's the good news. You don't need it. You don't need it to be happy. You don't need it to live a full life. There are 7 billion people in this world. If you tell me you have 2 people in your life that don't like you the way you are, well, so what? Right? I like you. God likes you. That counteracts all that other stuff, right? And if 2 unpleasable people say no to you, I can find a whole lot of people in this world to say yes to you. The Bible says, even if my mother and father forsake me, the Lord will receive me. That's how much God loves you. He says, I'm going to accept you no matter what. Here's the point. What God does for you, he wants you to do for other people. The Bible says, accept one another then, just as Christ accepted you. God says, I accept you guys unconditionally. I may not approve of everything you do. I may not approve of every choice you make, but I accept you just the way you are, and I love you just the way you are. So here's your homework. Remember, we're going to try to practice love Jesus style. So here's your first action step to work on this week. This week, I will show acceptance to fill in the blank. Think of a specific person. Name somebody who really annoys you. Name somebody who really irritates you. Don't elbow him. We all know what you're thinking. And when you're thinking, but Jeff, I don't feel like accepting that person. I don't feel like being nice to them or loving that person. Think how much Jesus has put up with when it comes to you. And then, I must value others like Jesus values me. I'm going to try to value other people just like Jesus values me. How valuable are you? How much are you worth? I'm not talking about your net worth. I'm talking about your self-worth. How much are you worth? Well, let me tell you how to get an accurate measurement of value. 2 things determine value. 2 things determine what something is worth. The first is, who made it? Value depends on who made something. You know, what's more valuable, a painting by Picasso or a painting by Jeff King, an original king? Well, obviously, you know the answer to that. People would pay millions of dollars for a sketch by Picasso on a napkin. They wouldn't give you a cent for a painting by Jeff King. It's who created it that makes it so valuable. Well, who created you? Almighty God, that's who. For we are God's masterpiece, says the Bible. You're a masterpiece. The Bible says everything God created is good. God doesn't create junk. God created you, and you're not junk. You are good. You're really good. In fact, you are a masterpiece. So value depends on who created it, and God created you. God made you. Second thing, value depends on what someone is willing to pay for it. Right? Let's be practical. What is your house worth right now? The answer is whatever somebody's willing to pay for it. Maybe you've got a baseball card collection. What's that worth? The answer is whatever you can get for it. Whatever somebody else is willing to pay for it. Recently, I heard about a member of the Saudi royal family. The king's daughter was kidnapped. So they took out great big full-page ads in the papers, and it said, "We will pay any price. She's a child of the king." You are a child of the king. And God is willing to pay any price for you. Any price, the ultimate price. The Bible says he paid for you with the precious life blood of Christ. So how much are you worth? Look at the cross. Jesus was saying on the cross, "I would pay the ultimate price for you." And he stretched out his arms and he said, "You matter this much to me. You are this valuable to me." Let me get real pointed. The people who told you growing up that you didn't matter, that you would never amount to anything, that you weren't worth squat, they were liars. They were lying to you. They may have even been your parents, but they lied to you. They may have said it in anger. They may have said it in hurt, but the fact is it was a lie, for you are valuable because God made you and Jesus paid the ultimate price for you. Now Jesus says, "Listen, I want you to treat everybody else like they're valuable too, because I love them too. Even the people you can't stand. Even the people who get on your nerves." So here's your second homework assignment. Action step. This week I will affirm the value of, and write down a specific name. Maybe somebody who needs a shot of self-esteem. And when everybody else treats them like dirt, I want you to treat them like gold. And third way to love Jesus style, I must believe in others like Jesus believes in me. Believe in others like Jesus believes in me. One of the worst things you can ever say to someone is, "You'll never amount to anything. You're worthless. You don't matter." Studies show that when a young person hears those words, "You'll never amount to anything," it has a tremendously devastating effect upon them. They wind up living with low self-esteem for the rest of their lives, and often they act out in self-destructive ways because of it. It's like a curse. It's like a curse that follows them around through life. Well, how do you reverse the curse? You start by believing what Jesus says about you instead of what other people say. Somebody else may say, "You'll never amount to anything." Jesus says, "You can do it. I believe in you. I know you got this. Don't give up." In fact, let me show you what Jesus thinks when he thinks about you. Jesus said, "If you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, 'Move from here to there,' and it will move. Nothing will be impossible to you." Maybe you look at your life right now and you see a mountain of problems out there. Maybe you see a mountain of debt, a mountain of uncertainty when you look at the future. Maybe you think, "It looks to me like this is going to be a tiring, tough climb to get over this, to get past this." But Jesus is saying to you this morning, through me, he is saying, "You got this. You can do this. I know what's inside of you. I know what I put in you. And I know that if you don't give up, you're going to do great things. You can do it." Jesus said, "Everything is possible for him who believes." So don't count yourself out yet. You can do it. Jesus said, I assure you, if you have faith and you don't doubt, you can do what I do, and much, much more you can do it. Jesus said, the truth is, anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done, and even greater works. You can do it. Folks, Jesus is the biggest cheerleader you have ever had in your life. No one has been rooting for you. Nobody has been pulling for you more than Jesus. Nobody believes in you more than Jesus. Maybe you're not sure you even believe in Jesus, but I'm sure he believes in you. In fact, think about this. Let me give you one final thought before we send you on your way. I want to do this to you this morning. Ready? Think of this. Jesus entrusted the future of the world to 12 fishermen. Think about that for a minute. Jesus entrusted the future of the entire world to 12 fishermen. And one of them kind of flamed out right at the beginning, never even got a good start. So now he's down to 11. These are just normal guys, blue collar. Not one of them had a high school degree. Not one of them had a college education. But he spends 3 years with them saying, okay, guys, I believe in you. You can do this. You're going to take my message all over the world. I know you're going to do this. Countries you've never even dreamed of. Continents you never even imagined. I'm trusting you guys. I believe in you. You can do this. So Jesus goes back to heaven, and the angels say to him, you died for all humanity, Jesus. How are you going to spread that good news around the world? And Jesus just kind of smiles and says, I got these guys. I got 11 guys. The angels look at each other bewildered. And they turn back to Jesus and say, what's your plan B? And Jesus says, there is no plan B. I believe in these guys. I know that they can do it. I'm going to trust them. And that's what Jesus says about you. He says, I got this group of people in Southwick. And I believe in them. I trust them. I know that they can do great things. You say, oh, wow, well, how do we start, Jesus? Let's get to work. Where do we begin? And Jesus says, you start by loving other people the way that I have loved you. So here's your final homework assignment. Action step. This week I will demonstrate trust in. Think of someone. Think of someone who has the potential for growth that you can say, I believe in you too. Maybe they don't even see the potential in themselves, but you see it. Maybe they remind you of you, of yourself when you were younger, when you're just getting started. And you remember for your own life, in your own life, you remember what it felt like when somebody you respected, when someone you looked up to said, I trust you. I believe in you. You can do it. And let me say those words to you right now. Not me, not Jeff, but let me be the voice of Jesus to you. I believe in you. I believe in you. I love you. I accept you. Always, unconditionally, just the way you are. You can't even begin to imagine how valuable you are to me. I would give my world, I would give my life, I would give my future for you. Having a tough time, I know it gets tough sometimes. Facing a mountain of troubles, you can do this. You got this. I believe in you. And now let's respond with our prayers. I invite you to bow your heads as we pray together. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you that you can heal broken hearts and bitter memories and damaged self-esteem. Thank you that old patterns can be erased and the curse can be reversed. Thank you that you turn nobodies into somebodies. Jesus, I ask that you help these people here today, these dear friends of mine, that you would help them begin seeing themselves through your eyes of love. And now you pray. In your heart, just say something like this. Dear Jesus, help me see myself the way you see me. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for dying for me. I don't understand it all, but thank you that you accept me and value me, and you trust me and believe in me. I want to believe in you. I want to trust you even more. Help me care more about what you think of me than what other people think. And with heads still bowed, I want you to repeat these words after me. Repeat these words silently in your mind and in your heart. Say to yourself, because of Jesus, I am acceptable. Because of Jesus, I am acceptable. I am valuable. I'm valuable. I am lovable. I'm lovable. I am capable. I am capable. In Jesus' name, amen. Now we pray together in unison that prayer that Jesus, the Lord of love, taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.